Good afternoon. It's a real pleasure to be back in Aswan to see a lot of familiar faces and also some new faces. I was allowed to come, but I had to give some presentations as well. This presentation is on the management of left ventricular outflow tract obstruction. So when we start, we have to define what left ventricular outflow tract obstruction is, and essentially it's a limitation of blood flow out of the left ventricle, which sounds a really simple definition, but actually, as you can see in this picture, it is at multiple level. It is left ventricle, subvalve, valve, supravalve. For the purpose of this lecture, we'll leave out the coarctation, but we'll be concentrating on that area. Valvar aortic stenosis is most common, then followed by subvalve and supravalve. And as will probably and hopefully become clear during the lecture, that it is not as simple as it appears. Already sort of alluded to, it is a heterogeneous condition, and with regards to the etiology, it is also complex. So most of the time it is congenital, and about 6% of congenital heart disease does involve the left ventricular outflow tract. It might be isolated, like here we have an isolated aortic valve stenosis, or it can be part of a much bigger problem, like here in hypoplastic left heart syndrome, where the whole left side of the heart is small. Sometimes we introduce left ventricular outflow tract obstruction as part of our treatment, and in, for example, AVSD repair, you can place your patch in a way that ultimately you will introduce left ventricular outflow tract obstruction. All the above are static, but you can also have a dynamic obstruction, as you have, for example, in HOCM, where in diastole the outflow tract is open, but in systole the anterior leaflet of the mitral valve is pushed into the outflow tract. So over the course of the next slides, we are sort of starting to break that down and look at it in some more detail. Ultimately, it is about patients and how do these patients present. The common symptoms are chest pain, dyspnea, and pre or true syncope. And on examination, there generally is a systolic murmur. However, in advanced cases where you ultimately get left ventricular failure, you obviously go and see the symptoms related to that. The timing of the presentation, again, is very multifactorial, and it depends on the degree and the level of obstruction. So obviously, if it is a critical aortic stenosis in a neonate, then the patient will present as a newborn. If it is an aortic stenosis related to a bicuspid aortic valve, you may have someone present in their 30s. Also, if there is a concomitant other cardiac abnormality, patients may present earlier because they may, for example, be duct dependent, and then when the duct closes, the left ventricular outflow tract obstruction will become apparent. And then finally, it may change because the working conditions of the heart change, and say aortic stenosis may be on Mars in pregnancy when the cardiac output goes up. So the clinical presentation, again, with regards to timing and symptoms, is quite variable. Why are we bothered about left ventricular outflow tract obstruction? Why do we take it serious with regards to treatment? The obstruction to forward flow does increase the afterload, so you end up with left ventricular pressure overload, which then will cause left ventricular hypertrophy, And that initially will give you diastolic dysfunction, but over time there is adaptive remodeling of the heart, you get the formation of fibrosis, and ultimately you get a dilated cardiomyopathy with heart failure symptoms and arrhythmias. So it is a condition that has to be taken very seriously. Most of the patients will therefore also present before the age of 50, so it's not a disease that we commonly see in the 80s or 70s. The other reason why sometimes patients come to our attention is because of infective endocarditis, because of the turbulence of flow over the outflow tract is a risk factor for developing endocarditis. So having diagnosed clinically that there may be a left ventricular outflow tract obstruction, the patient requires further hemodynamic investigation. And with that investigation, we need to identify what is the level of obstruction, how severe is the obstruction, and are there any other cardiac abnormalities? And this sort of illustrates that it is really important to have detailed cardiac imaging, because a simple subaortic membrane actually can look different. Also, say a subaortic membrane, you need to know if the membrane is very close to the aortic valve or is far away from it. And you also need to see the area above and below. So you need to have a very, very detailed level of obstruction. And you need to know how severe that obstruction is. And you need to know if there are other cardiac abnormalities, say if you have a bicuspid aortic valve. Yeah, you need to know whether or not there's a coarctation as well, because if you only treat the valve, then you will still have residual outflow tract obstruction. So at the As van Haart Center, you have fantastic imaging. First line of investigation is always going to be a cardiac echo. And that will give you a number of things. It will give you the structural abnormalities of the heart, and it will give you the function of the heart, and with Doppler interrogation you will get an impression about the severity. And then there are also the cross-sectional imaging modalities that will give you further clarity on what is going on. It's really important to realize that the cardiac loading conditions affect the findings, and you more or less know that if you have someone with severe aortic stenosis, a very poor function, and if the gradient over the outflow tract is 30, you're not going to classify that as mild aortic stenosis. Equally, if you have a patient with a hypertrophied heart on multiple inotropes that is hypovolemic, then that in itself can give you obstruction of the left ventricular outflow tract. Also, some of the time you can actually at rest, you will not see that there is obstruction, say for example in Hoken, but then if there is a Valsalva maneuver, you can actually demonstrate that there is outflow tract obstruction. So there are certain conditions where you also need to apply a trigger in order to show a dynamic obstruction. So now we have a patient, we have an outflow tract obstruction, and we have defined it that is severe enough to warrant treatment. For left ventricular outflow tract obstruction, most of the treatment is interventional. Most of that will be surgical. Come in, please. So most of it will be an intervention or a surgical procedure. So the timing will be determined by how bad the symptoms are, both at rest, but also what is that person doing. So if you have an active adult with moderate aortic stenosis, that that actually may be an indication for surgery, whilst if that person is 80 years old and doesn't do an awful lot, then actually surgery may not be warranted by someone of a different age. The first reason is obviously treatment of symptoms, but on the other hand, you want to avoid getting severe hypertrophy and dilatation. And in patients, say, that undergo aortic valve surgery and have severely hypertrophied ventricles, these patients will not have a normal life expectancy, and there is an excess death, excess sudden death in these patients. So you do not want to leave the treatment too long. On the other hand, there may be reasons why you may be worried about getting an adequate repair. Say, if there is a patient with moderate aortic stenosis, but that patient is still small, and you're not quite sure if you can treat that without introducing severe aortic regurgitation, then you may actually adopt an approach of careful watching and waiting until that patient becomes bigger, and you may have a much better alternative in case your treatment fails. And as with all congenital patients, we have to plan the treatment, both interventional and surgical, over a lifetime. So if your intervention involves the placement of a prosthesis, and if that patient is going to outgrow that prosthesis, yeah, you have to say, okay, can I maybe postpone a little bit, and can I do that safely? And then if that patient is bigger, I put in a bigger prosthesis in a few years' time. Also depends on comorbidities. If a patient has an other comorbidity, then can we wait if that is a comorbidity that gets better? Or actually, it's not going to get any better, it's not going to change anything, we just get on with it. The other important thing that is increasingly becoming importance is, what is the patient preference? Because it is ultimately the patient who lives with that repair. And it's no good you putting in, say, a mechanical aortic valve in a patient and that patient not wanting to take any warfarin. Yeah, you may not be in a position to offer a different treatment modality, but it is really important to listen to patients. Because they are the ones, as already said, who live with the disease, and they are the ones who will need to take responsibility for that disease. So there is a need for a patient-tailored approach, and that guides you with your setting of your indication and with your timing for the treatment. So now going through some of the conditions in a little bit more detail. So subvalve aortic stenosis, it is not just a membrane underneath the ventricle. So if you go back and think about the embryology that you sort of read quite a long time ago, the heart starts off as a simple tube that then bends and loops. So as a result, the inflow and the outflow are actually not in series, but in the heart they share a common space. And that has implications, because this is a limited space, and if there is something happening here underneath the aortic valve, it may be that that relates to something in here or something in there. But also, if you want to take something away here, it may have an impact on how the other things work. So the subaortic stenosis is actually can be quite a challenging condition. And if you look at the fibrous skeleton of the heart, again, inflow, outflow, yeah, you work in this space, but then there's a coronary here, a big vein here, so you're quite limited in where you can go. So what are the various types of subaortic stenosis? The most common and well known is the subaortic ridge. Yeah, where you either have a fibrous membrane or sometimes a fibromuscular membrane. But what isn't made clear is that a lot of these membranes actually also go up to the aortic valve and may also go down or up on the mitral valve. So it's not a simple shelf in one plane. And then going back to my previous comment about sharing the in- and outflow tract. So here, the membrane sits on the anterior leaflet of the mitral valve. Here, you have the mono-lined ventricular septum that you commonly see in coarctations, interrupted arches. So here is a little bit of the outflow septum protrudes in the left ventricular outflow tract, making that more narrow. And here there may be some that the leaflet is pulled in. Here is a lot of hypertrophy. This might be a Hocum patient. And this may be a patient that has a VSD with an aneurysmal septum that might protrude in the outflow tract. Obviously, if you excise that, you will create a VSD. And this is a patient that has maybe a transposition or something. And the aorta here, there's a conal septum here that is not aligned with the rest of the septum. And I'm sure all of you are familiar with Hocum, but in Hocum, at rest, there may not be a lot of obstruction, but definitely in diastole, the outflow tract seems open, but actually the aortic valve is closed, so not a lot of blood goes out. But then if you get towards systole, then the anterior leaflet of the mitral valve gets dragged into the outflow tract, and you may get obstruction, you get some systolic anterior forward motion, and quite often you get a posteriorly directed jet of mitral regurgitation. So the subaortic stenosis can be quite complex. So how do we treat this? Well, most of the treatment is surgical, although sometimes if it is the interventricular septum and the septal bulge that causes the obstruction, there is a limited role for ablation, but most of it is a surgical procedure which we do on cardiopulmonary bypass. And we get through the subaortic area from the top. So you make a vertical aortotomy, you then spread away the aortic valve leaflets, and then you look inside the outflow tract, so as you can see here. It's not an awful lot of space to work with. And particularly in small babies, there is hardly any space. And there, again, also, if you do these operations, if you can postpone a little bit, that's fine, but you may not be in a position to do so. Also, if you resect a subaortic membrane, there are lots of other things that are actually quite important that run there. So, obviously, you have your leaflets of the aortic valve, and it is very easy to damage the aortic valve leaflets. Then there is the bundle that runs in the septum, quite often in the area where the bulge is, where you want to excise. And then it's your anterior leaflet of the mitral valve, if you look through the aortic valve, that sits there. So again, if you cut away a membrane, and you have to be very careful not to make a hole in the mitral valve. So the considerations are that if you do this procedure, that you do a resection and you excise your membrane, which may be very close to the aortic valve. You may have to go towards the aortic valve and peel off membrane from the aortic valve. You may have to peel some membrane from the mitral valve. So if you were to be able to open that outflow tract, you take away tissue from this area, and that tissue may have moved upwards or may also have moved downwards. also in a subset of patients, particularly those with HOCM, yeah, it may be that the mitral valve leaflet, oh sorry, this is about myomectomy. So once you've taken away your fibrous membrane, yeah, you may actually wish to make a little bit more space in that outflow tract because it's almost a tunnel. You've peeled away the membrane, but the membrane quite often gets there because there is turbulence over that outflow tract, and that outflow tract either is a little bit angled or it was a little bit narrow. So if you can make that outflow tract bigger, then your risk of residual obstruction is less. So we quite often do a myomectomy and take some muscle out, and then again you have to put your myomectomy somewhere where you're away from the AV node, because otherwise you'll have heart block at the end of the operation. There is a very small subset of patients that has a very long tunnel outflow tract obstruction where there may or may not be a membrane at the end of that. And in those patients, just excising the membrane isn't enough, and you have to actually incise the interventricular septum and put a patch in the septum as well. So moving on from the sub-aortic area to the next level to the aortic valve, it's quite often not just isolated valve stenosis, but it's also a small or a smallish aortic root. So aortic valve stenosis is the most common pathology, and most of the time they're bicuspid aortic valves. And compared to the normal trileaflet aortic valve, the effective opening area for a bicuspid aortic valve is less. So if you consider that if you get some fibrosis or calcification of valve leaflets, then the same amount of calcification has a much bigger impact on a bicuspid valve because they start off with a smaller effective opening area. What can be, and quite often we see that we get some commissural fusion. So if we operate on these patients, we can try and cut open the commissures, hopefully not introducing too much aortic regurgitation. We can try and shave valve leaflets. But on the whole, a bicuspid aortic valve that gets stenotic, which already most often is a smallest valve, we cannot adequately repair these valves, and valve replacement is often needed. Again, I go back to my previous comment that you have to also say what is the age of this patient and so on. So if you're talking about a neonate, yeah, we'd be much more likely to do a commissurotomy and accept introducing moderate aortic regurgitation, rather than having to replace a valve at that point. Whilst in a patient who is 50 years old, where there may also be calcification of the valve, we will actually in that patient take out the valve and replace it. You already know all this, but aortic valve prosthesis, there is no perfect aortic valve, prosthetic valve. So all the valve substitutes that we use, they, none of them is perfect, and they all have their pros and cons. They fall into groups. Some are stented valves. These are valves that sit in a ring, and the ring helps to stabilize the valve, but also reduces the effective orifice of that valve. And then there are what we call non-stented valves, which are generally more pliable and actually will also move with the root if the root itself is dynamic. And again, the most commonly known for that is the Ross procedure, and you're all very familiar with that, where you take the patient's own pulmonary valve and move that to the aortic position, and that becomes the patient's new aortic valve. And then you use an other valve substitute to put that where the original pulmonary valve was. Homograft valves are also used, and in the short term they have excellent dynamics. The problem is they calcify, They calcify quite quickly in children, so we tend not to use them that much in the aortic valves. Again, the freestyle valve is quite commonly used here. It's got excellent hemodynamics, but they do wear out, and they're sometimes quite difficult to get out if you do a subsequent valve replacement. And then more recently, the Osaka technique has been coming up, where you really reconstruct the valve and stitch that inside the aortic root. So having had, in the short term, all these operations work actually really well. They have a drawback, because if you do a ROS or an aortic homograft in the techniques that we use, you need to transfer the coronary arteries. You might not be able to find a homograft. As already said, the tissues degenerate, and for the ROS operation, the patient comes in with single valve disease and goes out with double valve disease. And although they cope very well, it makes things more complex. So what about stented valve prosthesis, either mechanical valves or animal valves? They remain inferior, so there's a lot the companies tell us. They've done really marvelous things with the design of these valves. Ultimately, they still actually have a significant gradient over them. All the mechanical valves require anticoagulation. And for the small prosthetic valves, you actually have to really be aware what make valve you put in, because a 17 millimeter valve of one company has a totally different internal orifice area than a 17 millimeter for another valve company. So if you put in a 17 millimeter Onyx, you actually have a tiny valve. If you put in a 17 millimeter St. Jude, you have a much bigger valve. So you need to know that, but also you need to have them available. And also, although some valves, when you do the TUE at the end of the operation, you get 2 meters per second over it, you say, well, I've done quite well. If that is a patient that is in his 20s who wants to start to exercise, then actually that valve can go up, that gradient can go up quite a lot with exercise. So therefore, for a lot of patients that have a small aortic valve and therefore a small aortic root, you actually may have to embark on a root surgery in order to give that patient an adequate size valve. And that obviously does increase the surgical complexity. It puts the patient at a higher risk of bleeding and heart block. But if you have an extensive knowledge of the aortic root, then it is a really important thing to do that, to make sure that that patient goes out with an adequate size valve. And if we look at the aortic root, with the leaflets in here, the two coronary sinuses and a non-coronary sinus, then there are a number of techniques described that allow you to enlarge the aortic root. So you incise in the root at a particular place in order to create more space. So as already said, you need to be really aware of the anatomy. So if your root is here, you're never going to make an incision where your coronary runs. However, you can make an incision and go through the aortic mitral curtain and end up in the first part of your mitral valve. And obviously, you need to stay away from the membranous septum. So there are roughly 3 techniques for aortic root enlargement that are sort of used quite widely. The first one is called the NICS procedure, and in the NICS you go through the aortic valve annulus, then go to the non-coronary cusp and excise in the middle of the non-coronary cusp, which then gets you through the aortomitral curtain to where the free end of the mitral valve starts. So you can put in a little patch there, and then your annulus will be bigger, and it gets you generally one size valve up. And it is actually important to go, say, from a 19 to a 21 millimeter valve can be actually highly significant. If you need a little bit more space, there is a technique called the manubium. And rather than going in the non-coronary cusp, you go in the commissure between the non and the left coronary cusp with your left coronary artery sitting here. And then your incision again goes in the aorta mitral curtain, but goes then into the anterior leaflet of the mitral valve. You can incise to about a third of the height of that leaflet. Again, you put in a patch, so therefore your orifice area becomes bigger, and you put in a valve that is one or two sizes bigger. Surprisingly, you don't see a lot of mitral regurgitation afterwards, which is, when you do it the first time, actually it's quite scary to do. And then finally, so both of the previous techniques went to the back of the aortic root, because you ended up in the mitral valve anterior leaflet here. You can also go out to the front. You have to be a little bit careful, because you have a left coronary artery here and your right coronary artery there. But it's the interventricular septum that sits on here. So you can go in the commissure between the left and the right coronary artery, coming on the septum here. The conducting tissue sits here, so you're quite safe. You can incise that interventricular septum, that tends to be really, really thick in those patients. And then you need to open the right ventricular outflow tract as well, because if you incise, your scissors are sitting in the left ventricular outflow tract and in the right ventricular outflow tract, and then you put the patch in this area and you're able to get an aortic valve in that is generally two or sometimes three sizes bigger. In small babies, particularly those with critical aortic stenosis, where the aortic valve is really, really small, but the pulmonary artery is quite big, you combine a ROS with a Conno procedure. So if the pulmonary valve sits here, then you harvest your pulmonary valve for the ROS. You do that with a tongue of tissue. And then when you've taken out the small aortic valve, you incise again in the septum here and you turn your autograft, that is tongue of tissue, then sits in the outflow tract. And that really gives you a beautiful new aortic valve and outflow tract. You generally won't do this as a first procedure. These operations are generally done after you first done a balloon aortic valvuloplasty or a valvotomy. So now moving to the last level of that, and that is supravalvular aortic stenosis. And this is a catheter showing just above at the level of the sinotubular junction and discrete stenosis. Also importantly, we'll see the origin of the left and right coronary artery, arteries. So supravalvular aortic stenosis is associated with Williams syndrome. And these patients have a very thickened aortic wall. They may also have a hyperplastic aortic arch, or sometimes have a coarctation. But importantly, it may affect the coronary ostia. And you may either have coronary ostial stenosis, or occasionally you may have an intramural coronary, or you may have coronary atresia. So in these patients, as part of the preoperative workup, you need to demonstrate flow in the proximal coronary arteries. And if you can do that on echo, then that is all that is needed. If you can't visualize flow in the distal sort of proximal coronary artery, you need to do a cardiac catheter. And these cardiac catheters, again, are very high risk. But we had a child a couple of weeks ago that had an intramural coronary artery, and that was diagnosed at catheter, and went from the catheter then to have the surgery under the same anesthetic, avoiding a second anesthesia. So the surgery is patching out that area of stenosis. So traditionally it was a single patch, but then over time it's developed in a dual patch, and now sometimes people will transect and take out that ring of fibrous tissue and have three patches. There isn't that much difference in the rate of recurrence and adequate relief of outflow tract obstruction between a two and a three patch repair, but these techniques are significantly better than sticking to a single patch repair. And then, as a large part of the talk, a little bit about patient prosthetic mismatch, because you now all are very aware of the importance of putting in an adequate prosthesis, but you'll come across patients who will actually have small prostheses. And quite often, if you have a young patient who gets a 19 valve or a 21 valve, then very early on after surgery they do fine, but they come back within a few years with exactly the same symptoms again. So it's well recognized, and I think it is increasingly recognized, and these patients can be highly symptomatic, and they therefore then need redo aortic valve replacement, and in order to achieve that you will have to do some of those techniques to make the aortic root larger. We looked recently in our own patients, and we did 18 patients over a 7-year period. They all came in with small valves, and they had a number of techniques, so you really choose your technique depending on the local circumstances, how you think you can get an adequate valve in. In all these patients, we were able to get the valve size up, or we were able to go from a poorly designed valve to a better valve, giving a better effective orifice. And up to more than 2 years follow-up, then actually the improvement in gradient was sustained. So in conclusion, your left ventricular outflow tract obstruction is characterized by variability in the anatomical as well as in extent as well as the severity of the lesion. The timing of surgery and the type of surgical procedure is guided by a thorough understanding of the anatomy and the pathophysiology, and the aim should always be to achieve an optimal relief. Most commonly it involves a bicuspid aortic valve, and most commonly these patients will require an aortic valve replacement, and unfortunately we still don't have the best valve substitute. And long-term follow-up is mandatory in all these procedures, and many will require multiple operations over a lifetime. Thank you. Questions?
Is it frequent to do a cast in supravalve to assess the supravalvular segment and the coronary? And the CT can help and avoid the risk of coronary?
You're absolutely right. So the anesthetic and the anesthetic induction are really, really high risk. So echo is the first choice, and sometimes you have beautiful echo pictures. And most of these patients are young, they're sort of 2 years or 4 years old, and CT doesn't always give you the detail that you need. You may not be able in a three-year-old to reliably diagnose an intramural coronary on CT. We were actually a little bit laid back about that because we hadn't seen a lot of problems, and then in one patient we had an anesthetic induction and a child arrested at anesthesia for surgery, and we thought we'd seen the coronaries, but actually looking back, we probably hadn't. And at the time of the operation, we were lucky because we found just a shelf occluding the orifice, but the distal valve was, distal coronary was fine. And then a few months later, we obviously were much more aware, and we couldn't see the coronaries. We took a patient to the catheter lab, but that patient then arrested, and luckily the operating theater next door was ready, and that patient had surgery. But that child ultimately actually had almost coronary atresia, so had an operation, went on ECMO, and in the end didn't come off ECMO. So we think, looking back, maybe it was a little bit too much time as well. So now we take these patients to the cath lab, and we do an angiogram, and then we look at the angiogram, and if it is operable, if there is no coronary artery disease, it's fine. If it is operable coronary artery disease, like an intramural coronary, we carry on and do the operation in, we now have a hybrid lab, in the hybrid lab. If there is aortic atresia, we will actually then not operate, because if you change the coronary perfusion pressures by relieving the supravalve aortic stenosis, then actually you may not have adequate coronary perfusion when you come off bypass. So it's really because of a number of experiences has changed how we approach these patients, and probably for the next 10 we'll have normal coronary arteries on echo, but we're definitely much more alert.
So you are routinely do coronary angio for young who cannot demonstrate it by
sleep? Exactly. If we cannot demonstrate on echo, and we have really good echo people, so if we cannot demonstrate it, then that would, and if that means sort of you do an echo and you can't see it, then because the child is unsettled, we're very happy to do a sedated echo. But if we then still can't see it, and we found out that if we can't see it on echo, there is actually a coronary problem.
Because most of the such cases have hypertrophy and dominant coronary.
Yeah, they should have, but it's part of the syndrome.
Yeah.
So we know for the best long-term results for the aortic valve replacement or the ROS operation has done very well. Yet there is a problem of availability, as you have mentioned, and complexity. So not all surgeons are well trained in that operation. There has been a lot of enthusiasm doing the Osaki procedure for children, and I'm starting to get some reports that this enthusiasm has started weaning off because of not great longer term results. Have you had any experience with that, and what do you
think? We exactly hear those things as well, and the early results have been really good. We've just got the ethical approval through, and we're just starting the program, but we've actually had good results with our losses. The problem appears to be the material that you use to do the Osaki. So if you use definitely bovine pericardium, doesn't work. If you use some of the new tissue engineered pericardial substitutes, again, they have no durability. There are some reports of having good results with non-treated autologous pericardium, but again, it's not a sustained reproducible result. So, I mean, the good thing about the Osaki is that you don't change that much about the root. You take out the aortic valve, you don't do anything about the coronaries, you don't replace the root. So, yes, you need to do a redo operation. And the Osaki has to be seen as a step in the management of the small aortic root. So if you can say do that in a 5-year-old and you get that child out to 15, and then you do a ROS or another procedure, it is a very useful technique, but it is not a technique that is a one-off, take all, and it now grows and you don't need anything more.
Karen, I would like to share your experience with us about two topics that are controversial here in the center. The first thing is about adaptation of our facilities. We have a strong opinion against that in the center, but we would like to listen to the other experience when we can use it. And about the new data loss. So, if you can share your experience.
So, with regards to balloon valvuloplasty, or surgical valvotomy, the palliative procedures. So again, you have to see it as part of a lifetime treatment. In Leeds, we've always had quite strong intervention cardiology and very long surgical waiting lists. Yeah, which at some point pushed it towards the balloons, but then we had a change of operators and we saw some aortic regurgitation, probably more than we had expected. So we now have a policy that if we have say bicuspid aortic valve where we can see the commissures, then and the child has good ventricular function, then we'd go for a surgical valvotomy, or if there is an indication to do an operation anyway. So if there is a hyperplastic aortic arch and a stenotic aortic valve, then we'll go in from the front, do the arch repair and do an open valvotomy. If the valve looks really dysplastic, yeah, then with surgery, you can't see any identifiable anatomical structures either. Or if the child has very poor function, because then we absolutely do not want to put it on bypass and cardioplegia the heart. So we've come to a patient-specific approach, recognizing that actually there are pros and cons, because if you were to do an open valvotomy purely for surgery and you don't do any other procedures, then the next time you're in for a redo, although actually it's not a really big thing to do a redo. So it's a slightly sort of balanced approach. And then obviously if the surgeons have one or two valves and we have a new colleague come in is a little bit too enthusiastic and we end up with having a few with aortic regurgitation, then the cardiologist is saying, oh, we should do it. And we're doing it, and then we have a few of those, and then the next thing is we say, you got an awful lot of regurgitation and now have to do an emergency neonatal ROS. And then it swings the other way again. So we're trying to find the balance.
Okay.
Yeah. Neonatal ROSes, probably one of quite a big experience. We looked it up. It's somewhere on my computer is a presentation on that. I think we did about 8 ROS conos without mortality. Maybe we've been lucky because the reported mortality is about 25-30% in most series. You don't have an other choice for some of these patients. So you have a neonate that has had an aortic balloon quite often. They either, the ones we've had, and many of them has been acute ones, and they've either had a really bad valve, and then when the valve was opened, there was severe acute AI, yeah, or the valve was opened and there was some aortic regurgitation, which initially was manageable, but then actually the hypertrophy went down, and then in a few months' time that child has a dilating heart and goes into heart failure. You have to do a ROS cono because the native aortic, the native pulmonary valve is a lot bigger. When you do your cono, because you go in the septum between the left and the right coronary arteries, actually you push the arteries away from each other. And that means that when you put your new root in, you have to really be careful how, well, you position it with a tongue of tissue, but you still have to be careful how you put it in, because sometimes otherwise your coronaries end up where the commissures are. And then there is obviously also a mismatch between the proximum of the anastomosis of the top end of the root, because you do it as a root, and the ascending aorta, so you need to patch that out as well. They're quite challenging operations, yeah. But we did 8. One was on ECMO pre-op. All had severely impaired ventricular function, and all were done as urgent cases. And 2 years later, all have normal ventricular function, so there's been really good remodeling. All the new aortic valves are working well, and interestingly, the child that was on ECMO pre-op came out of theater without ECMO. Mm-hmm. The real issue has been the RV to PA conduits, because you need to put in a neonate a homograft. Mm-hmm. You don't have small homographs, so you either need to take an adult homograft and need to make that smaller, or you need to put in a Contegra valve. Mm-hmm. And none of those are really sort of the best. And also the height of the Contegra valves and the homograft is actually quite high for a neonate. So you need to mobilize the pulmonary arteries quite extensively, and then have all sorts of tricks to enable to get it in. And we had to replace 2 of the homographs within 2 years.
Oh, yeah.
Say that again?
As you said, in such a point, when in one case, you mean when you need a critical aortic stenosis, you prefer to work for a balloon aortic dilatation rather than surgery?
No, it depends on the anatomy of the valve, because balloon valvuloplasty is a blind procedure, so you have no influence where the tear goes. Whilst with surgery, you can see the commissures and you can open the commissure on the direct vision. So if you have a valve that clearly is a bicuspid aortic valve with commissural fusion, then I think with a surgical valvotomy, you get a better result, because you get less aortic regurgitation. Yeah, you have to be careful not to be over enthusiastic, and it's much better to end up with a little bit of residual stenosis that you may then well balloon in the lab, than opening it too much and end up with aortic regurg. However, if it is a very dysplastic unicuspid valve, as a surgeon you can't see where to open it. Yeah, in exactly the same situation as the interventional cardiologist. Well, then it's much better to do a balloon, because then you don't have to open the chest. Yeah, or if the cardiac function is really poor, and some of these babies come in a collapsed state. But then we were always really careful. We'd rather do 2 sequential balloons over a period of a few weeks than overdoing it and ending up with no stenosis but severe regurgitation. And I think that is, I mean, you're much better informed about than I am, but that I think is what the general people say, okay, you want this child a little bit better, but you do not want severe AI.
Prof advised us not to do any aortic balloon, because there is a bad history regarding a lot of acute aortic regurg early practice in our center.
Yeah.
So we
prefer
open balloon, especially we do not receive a lot of neonates with critical aortic stenosis, as we are referral center.
Yeah, you're absolutely right.
Most of our referral kids are stable enough to go to open
I mean, the ones that we get, the 2 or 3 days old, and they're really, really in bad shape. But that is with a number of treatment modalities, isn't it? You have to live with the history of those who come for you. Also in adult congenital heart disease, you have to live with what the surgeons did before you and the reputation. And I think you have to find out what works in your center, because in some centers you have really good interventional cardiologists, some centers have
you
really
have
good surgeons, and some centers have both. Yeah. Any other questions?
First of all, thanks for the lecture. It's really great to some of many concepts that we recently have been talking about. So what about your experience in aortic valve repair? I've been talking about different modalities for replacement. Yes, aortic valve repair is sometimes a choice in aortic insufficiency. But in the options that we can do,
yeah, so the problem with the stenosis is that you have very little tissue to work with. So it tends to work better in aortic insufficiency because the annulus tends to be bigger and you have prolapsing valve leaflets and so on. So you have something to work with. A stenotic valve quite often already has a small orifice area, so you can't sort of plicate the commissures or do something because the valve becomes more stenotic. And quite often by the time they come to you, there is also severe calcification or fibrosis. So in a stenotic valve, there isn't a lot of scope, unless you were to take a leaflet out and put a new one in. So then you're talking Ohsaki procedure. Yeah. In a regurgitant valve with a good annulus, there is a lot more scope to, and then you can also do valve sparing routes and so on if you need to do something there. But I haven't been that successful in stenotic valves. Most of the time it's a conservative valvulo commissurotomy. Any other questions?
Thank you very much.
No? Thank you.